Hey, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all of the other episodes, check the link in the description, stop by raprankings.com, or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform. And please consider liking, subscribing, and commenting to help us grow the channel and continue our journey as hip-hop's first and premier extreme podcast. Track 5, The Red, featuring Quasimodo, produced by Jay Dilla. Oh, brother, now we talking, man. 8-.
Flat 8, ding me baby. So this is, now keep in mind we're doing the actual version of The Red we briefly discussed during the background info about what happened here and why the album needed to be re-released.
Yeah. We're doing the initial pressing.
Get into it. Can we play both?
Oh, sure. Sure.
Let's play the one we're actually reviewing tonight first.
No doubt. Well, let me pull it off here. That's a project. It's any kind of music. Oh, okay. I thought you. All right, let me pull it out the sound. Okay, my personal library. Check it out, y'all.
Your niggas like, what the fuck is this?
Shit.
Damn, look at this, what kind of luck is this? Mad Libman, dealers, illest, my nigga. Only haters holler, they can't feel us. Niggas wanna get looser than we. But just gonna be a loser to me and Dilla. Killer, talking about how you pill Casper, nigga, you're softer than the pillar.
That was the moment I was talking about, by the way, the flow. I don't know what it is about it, but like, I pop for, you just gonna be a loser to me and Dilla. Okay.
So I think I've mentioned this on the show before in some capacity, but like that beat is Dilla doing Dre, as far as I'm concerned. Like he does a really good job of it too. He'll talk about Dre a bit in the next interview clip we're going to play later.
Okay.
I think he was trying to like get in with Dre's camp. And this beat is like the reference beat for Dre, basically.
I see.
Now, it's a shame what happened to this song. Now, we had a situation back in season 0 when we did Food by MF Doom.
Cookies.
Where Cookies lost the Sesame Street sample.
And we had a debate because I thought they were both great. And you thought the replacement was a fucking travesty.
It's a travesty. And it's a travesty because, you know, I got the original pressing of that album. I was used to one version. I'm not going to accept any other version at that point. And I don't care for it. Here's a situation where we actually reviewed in season 6 on Patreon, Cuban Links 2. Mm-hmm. And this beat was later repurposed for 10 Bricks by Raekwon, which we'll play after we play the Red re-release version. I like the Raekwon song. It's one of my higher rated songs on that album, if I recall.
Okay.
I don't like this beat for the Red. It does not replace the Red.
Well, let's hear that replacement beat.
Niggas like, what the fuck is this? Damn, look at this, what kind of luck is this? Mad Libman, dealers, illest, my nigga. Only haters holler, they can't feel us. Niggas wanna get looser than we. But just gonna be a loser to me and Dilla. Killer, talking about how you pill Casper, nigga, you're softer than a pillar. Back slapping your neck while you're coming to wreck. Cause you're bluffing and you ain't said nothing, it's bad. Going long. Anyway, I'm straight high off the trees. Your girl don't wanna lie, she just wanna get on her knees. Turn it up. Y'all niggas must be out of your head if your sister made up to the Red.
He said,
now here's,
y'all like, what the fuck is this? Exactly. What the fuck is that?
Oh, man. Well, here's the thing. I think that beat is cool, too.
I like the beat. Yeah.
It's not like it touching for the original.
Red. No, and it's not the right kind of beat. Like, they didn't even go for, like, a beat that knocked similarly to the Red.
Right. And the thing is about that replacement beat, that's a beat you got to, like, bar out on.
And like, now let's and play Madlib's
not that kind of rapper.
Right. Know? And and fair play to Madlib. He didn't know that his verse was going to end up on that beat.
Right.
Let's hear what Raekwon did with that beat, because I much prefer 10 Bricks.
Yeah. Iron Chef. Just need you to come back into the world. Just grab the store over here. Hey yo, rappers stepping to me, they want a brick, son. But I'm the chef, my price is 26, son. Moving pop, I left 32 of those in Opa Locker. Those soldier got locked up, blow killed the doctor. Flamboyant police, is X5s watching my loft. So many leeches, I just left it in war. My flow wicked, Miami money moving, man, ridiculously. Geico on the arm, froze, rose gold with me. Take baths with white women, lingerie see-through. Taking trips to Iran, my Spanish nigga people. Selling drugs to Flatbush, call my nigga Sisu. Snub with the black gloves on Half Moon Creek, dude. Killed him in the Bahamas, his white brand, white van pulled up. They caught him out in Brooklyn with a white man. Slutted out, rosed out, sister was gone, she geeking. She threw the rifle in her mouth and said, good evening, up Paul Wall, real line to get money, crime thief. I know her from Africa, pretty smile, nine teeth, gold joints, frames only, Louis Vuitton, pony.
It fits more,
yeah,
you know,
yeah. Much more, and it sounds more like a Wu-Tang type of beat than something that is going to be replacing the Red beat.
He went from Dre to RZA.
Yeah, that's exactly what they did. It doesn't work for me. Now, I'll say this about Madlib on here. I think his rapping is fun, but this beat is so good that it should have gone to someone better.
Yo, man, listen, what the fuck? Sometimes Moulz Mel be connecting in such a way, I be shook. I said, as much as I enjoy the clunky rapping, actual bars on this would have gotten the minus knocked off and maybe even a plus.
Like, I'm just thinking about like the time period. I'm like, oh my God, what if 50 Cent was on here? What if Busta was on here? Like,
you know,
what this would have sounded like. Now, I've gotten looks playing this. Because they hear the beat, and you get that, like, screw face off the beat immediately. Yeah. Especially, just it cuts on, just like, you know.
Yeah.
So, you get that immediately, and these knocking-ass drums, and you're just boom, like, boom. Oh, this is crazy. Yeah. What is this?
Yeah.
And then an outsider, a casual, a normal person, here's Madlib's rapping and they give me a face. You know, it's like they know that the rapping's not hard enough for this beat. And again, I like the rapping well enough. I've talked about it extensively on the Quasimodo review that we did. I think Madlib playing off of Quasimodo works best for him as a rapper. It's funny. And it also kind of gives him something to bounce off of rather than just like maybe what we were getting on nowadays, which wasn't really resonating with either of us. Mm-hmm. I just could imagine someone more capable absolutely killing this record and like Dilla making a lot more money from it as a result.
I feel you, man, because like, This beat is so fucking hard by its fucking self. Like, I'll be honest, fucking Madlib could have farted on this and I still would have took it away because this is the beat of the album so far to me. And I feel like with this beat, Dilla raised the bar for production on the album. I feel like they kind of eased into it. They were going back and forth, kind of taking it easy. Once this beat hits, it's like, all right, your move, Madlib. Because the bounce is fucking ridiculous. Like, the way that filtered sample weaves in and out is, like, it ducks down during the verses and then back during the chorus. But it's, like, you know, filtered. Everything about this beat is, like, fucking perfect to me.
Yeah, it's an amazing beat. It's it's the song itself is tied with two other records on here for my favorite on the album. But this may be the best beat on the album.
I got a song coming up that I enjoy slightly more. But this is in terms of, yeah, in terms of ratings. Yeah, this is only this and another song. But yeah, you know, what's crazy is prepping for this episode. You know, I was making sure I secured the original versions. And I remember telling you on the phone, it was like weeks ago. I'm like, I thought this was the remake version because of like the bass line and the synth work and everything. And the sample isn't as prominent as the remix version, you know, because right. like especially during the verses where it's kind of, you know, the sample is kind of buried and you just hear Madlib rapping. I thought it's like, oh, they have to do a remake where it's like the drums and the bass are doing more work because they don't have the synth. Because like the remix, it's obvious it's a sample that's getting chopped up. But this was the original.
It was surprising this is what to me. Madlib's actually rapping on. He never knew that his verse was going to end up on that other beat. And to that end, it's like crazy to me. Quasimodo, who's it's Madlib, but you know, Quasimodo basically young pinches Jaylib because that line, mostly shitty women, is so unessential. While it is funny, it sucks that like nobody will ever hear this beat again by conventional means because an alien talked about shitty women and it offended the artist who was sampled. We talked about on SoundCloud Gems how Young Pinch had a hit with Smoke and Drive. It just so happened, though, that he sampled Weezer, Island in the Sun, and Rivers Cuomo. It's weird with a guy who has a first name that's Rivers. It sounds pluralized, but his last name is Cuomo, but then you have to pluralize Cuomo. Rivers Cuomo's dad. Right. Sounds so weird. Died as a result of a drunk driver, so he wouldn't clear the sample because the song was called Smoke and Drive.
Right. Reasonable explanation. Yes. And like we now, talked about here in the info, this didn't get cleared because they tried to make it seem like it was her fault, but it was like, oh, this crazy feminist.
Right. She's like a hyper feminist. And it's like, at the end of the day, she's the writer and the, you know, the artist who made the song that's being sampled.
Right.
She's the one in charge of clearing it.
You know?
It's up to her discretion, you know, to bring him up here. Kanye West wanted, I think it was like a Patti LaBelle sample for School Spirit.
Yeah,
and she would not allow it unless he censored it.
Right.
So, you know, there they found a compromise. Here, she might have just been so offended by the line, she maybe wasn't willing to do business.
Well,
what I'm saying is, in a different situation, maybe with a major label and like intermediaries and stuff like that, this maybe would have never happened because it's like, you know, if there was an issue with any kind of content with getting it cleared, they might have known up front. And there was actually a chance of getting it cleared.
You know, to be fair though, it was more than just like, yeah, that line specifically, but before that he was like, yo, that nigga's wild, like wildlife animals, Hannibal, cannibals, male bashers, womanizers, nymphos, niggas in disguises, fine women that, like pretty women, some ass women, some titty
pops
women.
Me, by the way. The whole thing
shitty
is,
women.
You know, it's very like out there, but I enjoy it. He's, to me, like, he knows he can't live up to this beat.
Right. So,
he's not even going to try.
that's a fun interpretation. Yeah.
So he's just kicking some rhymes on it.
And right,
they're not
like the listing
rhymes. Like they're fun raps to me. But I know from the faces people have made and the juxtaposition between how it starts off and then what their face eventually turns to when they hear the rapping. I know this rapping is not up to par to the casual ear.
All right.
I do think he works best, though, in situations where he gets to play off of Quasimodo, and this is one of them, and therefore it works for me better than when he's just straight up Madlib.
Fair enough. Yeah. Oh,
The 80s arcade beat interlude at the end is
awesome.
Oh,
yeah, I said, did I hear Street Fighter noises at the end? Yeah, that's what's
happening. Yeah, it's like some 1980s like arcade sounds and stuff. It's cool. There's a bunch of beat interludes throughout this album. I enjoy this one.
Yeah. Listen, the thing about beat stingers, it always seems to be the best producers that like to throw these little like teasers and stingers and bite-sized pieces.
Pete Rock, J Dilla.
And I'm just like, you motherfuckers, because it's always like the illest shit you didn't hear like in months, and it's just a snippet of it. You know?
Sometimes it ends up becoming a full track later on down the line, and I think in some ways it's like that producer's advertising to their clients, like, hey, this one hasn't been used yet.
Well, interesting.
I was actually just listening to Heavy D and the Boys.
Oh, you gotta love him.
And I heard a beat that I recognize as an interlude on a Gangstar album. And I'm like, Primo got someone on this beat for years. I always thought like he just was an interlude and like no one ever rapped on it. I'm like, oh, this is a Heavy D song. Okay. Hmm.
Yeah. I mean, I was talking earlier about, you know, bringing in some archival. It's coming up. But like, yeah, there's a stinger on here. But what's interesting is apparently I think it had already been used and this like the stinger was like a reworked version of it or something. We're getting there.
Is it at the end of Heavy?
Is it at the end of Heavy? Yes.
Okay, because I literally wrote the beat interlude at the end is amazing, and I think it ended up getting used by someone, but I can't remember who.
It did. I brought it in because it made me, it was one of the stingers that made me mad. I'm like, how you just gonna throw this fire ass shit at the end? And you know, like, but
all right, well, it's coming up next.
It is coming up next. And I mean, I don't have anything else to say about the rail other than the shit is hard as bricks. And I have one of my patented jokes. Okay, although it's not a joke because I'm in danger in this thing. And so here we go. Who do I have to deal with on the internet? Because Moulz and the real hip hoppers have incited and encouraged hostility towards me and my hip hop opinions. Any guesses? You don't know? No.
Mel bashes.
Let me say on that subject before we move on, Jesse, don't use the Mel Ain't Rap account to pursue your anti-female rap agenda.
well to be fair, I don't think he did it on purpose. I think it was accidental, but yeah, he tweeted one of his classic at from old Harlem, like, you know, Jesse Quali ass tweets from the Mel Ain't Rap account, which is supposed to be dedicated to him making fun of me and not having hip-hop knowledge.
He doesn't do that anymore. He hasn't been able to do that to Mel in like 2 months, but he suddenly popped up with something about Nicki Minaj fans talking about Swarm was a documentary. Yeah. Delete that fucking tweet, Jesse.
Well, delete it, but actually in terms of like the tweet's fine because those fans are kind of, you know, not well. So
what is that doing on the dedicated account for Mel not being rap?
He probably didn't realize he did it, you know,
because he's that obsessed with burying.
He was so feverish.
Women
he
rappers, was... their fans, all of it.
He was, his hands were shaking holding the phone. I got to get this take off. Okay. No more women. You know, like, we know about him. But anyway, you want to move on?
Yeah.
Hey, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all of the other episodes, check the link in the description, stop by raprankings.com, or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform. And please consider liking, subscribing, and commenting to help us grow the channel and continue our journey as hip-hop's first and premier extreme podcast.